a mom, 8 months pregnant, she's getting her kids ready for school in the morning. Suddenly, uniformed officers show up at her door. They arrest her. They take her away for no reason. A poet is commanded to go to a police station, and it is a terrifying order because so many people he knows have already vanished into secret detention centers. A young mother grabs her baby and runs, but the soldiers are faster. They kill dozens of people, including her infant daughter. Artificial intelligence played a significant role in each of these human rights violations. If you are surprised that AI can be so dangerous for human rights, so was I, and I'm a human rights researcher. In my work as an anthropologist studying violence and genocide, I've met people facing unwarranted arrest and detention, people living in fear of forced disappearance, people who have survived genocide. I have stood in the mass graves like those soldiers left behind in that young mother's village. And I can pinpoint the moment that I began to feel very concerned about AI's threats to human rights. It wasn't anything high-tech, strangely enough. It was paper. Lots and lots of paper. 80 million pages of official police files documenting torture, secret prisons, murder. All of this evidence had been dumped, hidden in a basement left to mildew and rot until it was discovered completely by accident. These pages document what happened during Guatemala's genocide, in which 200,000 people lost their lives. These pieces of paper were used to track and kill. Fichas, which are like index cards with fingerprints and photos, used for intensive surveillance of students, union members, journalists. Huge logbooks with lists of names, some of them with a code written next to them, a secret code for assassination. Standing in those piles of paper, I began to understand how dangerous data can be, how in the wrong hands, data becomes a weapon. That a ficha, an index card, can be every bit as deadly as a bullet, and that a list of names can fill a mass grave. Imagine if the dictators in Guatemala didn't just have paper. Imagine if they had AI. Imagine if they had facial recognition technology that can pick someone out of a crowd. Imagine if they had spyware to plant in phones or deep fakes to make incredibly convincing propaganda. How many more people would have been killed? Dictators have this technology now. Paper has become computer code. Logbooks have become algorithms. Nothing needs to be hidden in a basement because everything is concealed in the cloud. The United Nations High Commissioner for Human Rights has warned that many current uses of AI are not compatible with human rights. This means things like facial recognition, a technology with racial bias encoded, a flawed technology that can make misidentifications. That's what happened to Portia Woodruff, that mom taken away from her kids one morning in Detroit. Things like biometric mass surveillance that can be used to track and persecute religious and ethnic minorities. That's what happened to Tahir Hamid Izgil, a Uyghur poet in China. Or social media that is used to amplify hate and circulate disinformation, like in the Rohingya genocide in Myanmar, that a young mother named Hasina survived, but that her baby daughter did not. It isn't just militaries or governments or authoritarian leaders or bad actors who use AI for surveillance. It's us. It's you and me. Welcome to luxury surveillance, which is a term that the brilliant surveillance researcher Dr. Chris Gilliard uses to describe how we enjoy and we pay for technologies like smartphones, smartwatches, also smart thermostats, smart doorbells, smart refrigerators, smart cars, not to mention ChatGPT, TikTok, cat memes, doom scrolling, all this technology that's part of our lives. I probably don't have to tell you that these kinds of technologies are generating massive amounts of data. You might have thought about this in terms of a privacy risk, and you'd be absolutely right. One study showed that in anonymized data sets, 99.98% of individuals could be re-identified. That means there's no such thing as anonymous data. So this is a huge privacy issue, but it is more than that. It is a human rights threat. Because data can be weaponized against activists, against dissidents, against journalists, against moms and poets, against anyone. Have you ever chatted on social media? Last year, Facebook handed over private chats between a mother and daughter, a discussion about reproductive choices, to police. Have you ever used Twitter when it was called Twitter, or gone to a march or a rally? In 2020, an AI startup collected tweets from peaceful protesters and sent that data directly to police. Your posts may have been among the millions that they rounded up. Did you know that your face is being used right now in facial recognition systems? Companies scrape the internet for our photos. One company has 30 billion images. That is more than 3 images for everyone on Earth. Your face and the face of everyone you love is in that data set. Most likely. Mine is. It means they can identify us. It also means that our faces are being used to train sophisticated surveillance technology that this company sells all over the world to governments, to law enforcement, to private companies. It's a business model that the ACLU has called reckless and dangerous, that the New York Times has said will end privacy as we know it. Do you want your face used like this? No one asked you. So here's a challenge. Every time you see something advertised as a smart technology, replace the word smart with surveillance. Surveillance phone, surveillance speakers, even surveillance city. That's creepy, and it's dangerous. It is dangerous because data can be dangerous to you, to someone you know, to someone half a world away. Now, technology companies know how dangerous data can be. And we know that they know from lawsuits, from whistleblowers, from leaked documents, from investigations by the UN and human rights groups like Amnesty International. Big tech knows the risks and harms. This is not sci-fi future. This is what's happening right now to people like Portia and Tahir and Hasina and many others. We don't allow automotive companies to sell cars without crash tests. We don't allow pharmaceutical companies to release medications without drug trials. But we allow technology companies to unleash untested, powerful, dangerous technologies built on our data. Our data is the fuel of the tech economy. Our data is what has made technology companies superpowers on a global scale, rivaling nation states. Did you know that Microsoft is wealthier than Russia? Or that Apple is worth more than 96% of countries? Of the 10 richest men in the world, and yes, they're all men, 8 are in tech. They have tremendous personal power and personal wealth, and they are shaping our world. With their rockets, with their satellites, with their car companies, with their robotics, with their social media platforms, with their newspapers. I think of them as the new princes of AI. In the history of the world, kingdoms have been built on many things, on spices, on gold, on oil, and now on AI. These princes of AI have every bit as much power as politicians, as heads of state, but no one elected them. And just like in a monarchy, we can't vote them out. That's not democracy. So when the princes of AI say artificial intelligence increases efficiency, ask, efficiency to do what? Because mass surveillance is a lot more efficient than those piles of paper that I saw in Guatemala. But it is no less dangerous. When the princes of AI say, artificial intelligence is going to make things more convenient and easier. Hey, you don't have to show your ID and your ticket at the airport anymore. We'll just scan your face. Ask, easier for who? And whose lives will be put at risk by the same technology? When the princes of AI tell us that our data is theirs to use as they please, that their technologies are inevitable, that we just have to trust them, what are we going to say? Are we going to accept a kingdom of AI that puts our rights at risk? Generations that came before us fought for our human rights, struggled for our civil rights. Will we fight to put human rights at the center of AI? Will we fight to democratize technology for the generations that come after us? The future isn't written yet. The future that our children and their children will live in. And one thing that princes tend to forget is that they are not the sole authors. Ordinary people, people like us, we can write the future too. Thank you.